and Koji here, back with another pillow talk, where we discuss sex, loss, love, and art. I know many of you are wondering where the hell Heey is. Faye, do you want to share with them?
It's been a minute today.
Yeah, so we'll be discussing desire today. So first we're going to start off by giving you guys a little dream that I had, a download from my ancestors. Yes, and the dream was basically surrounded around three beverages. So I was at school one day, and my friend told me that I had left my bag on stage. And me being lazy, I didn't want to carry my bag around with me anyway, so I told her that I'm just going to leave there. And she told me again, Caleb, go back for the bag because it's at risk of being stolen. So I contemplated, and as I was walking to the stage, I came across three bottles. And those three bottles, I thought to be ginger ale. Little did I know, and me not even questioning if these bottles were alcohol or whatnot, I just drank the bottles because they looked familiar. So when I drank the bottles, I was like, why do these taste like alcohol? And when I looked at the bottle, I was just like, wait, hold up, this says ginger rum. So I was taken back by that, and as I was leaving the stage, I was about to leave my bag, and then I went back for my bag, and I went to the bus where my friends were waiting for me, and I enjoyed my journey home. So what I think of the key points in that dream, first thing that comes to mind is the bag. And the bag relates to home, self-love, our valuables, the inner,
like your position.
Yeah, that inner compass, like all that we embody. That's what I think of bag. And when I think of the bus, I think of trip, and I think of desire being an exploration, a vehicle. And then when I think of the soda's appearance, what first comes to mind is what we desire is not always what we expect it to be. Things that may seem familiar are actually unfamiliar to us. And then that also makes me question myself and ask myself, what I'm desiring, is it truly an inward desire, or is it an outward desire? And outward desire meaning societal projections that make us feel like we desire these things.
But this is desirable.
Yeah, because it's projected to us to make it look like we actually want these things. So we fall to that.
So that's what I think of when I think of these sort of appearance. So how do you feel about that dream?
Friend, I just feel like that just heavy. Like, not heavy, but it's just so layered. And then I thought about just how sometimes even, so to the three soda, so just sometimes even though we have three things to choose from, or a couple people to choose from, so we're like, oh, this, it looks familiar, meaning that we think we experienced before, and this is what we like, this is what we desire, this is what's interesting to us. And then these three things, start to compare them. See? Or you think they're different. You think all of them different. It's three boxes. They look and look like ginger ale. That's coming to this. And it's wrong. And I feel like I could connect that to that being you thinking it's something else because you've experienced it before, because you think you know it and you think you want it. But then when you actually experience it, it's just like, whoa.
Hold up,
I just bumped my toe.
And I didn't know what I was getting myself into. I didn't know what
no,
I was getting
you're drunk. Into. You're literally intoxicated with this person, with these people. Like that you just like jumped into because you didn't take the time to actually examine or even just
introspect.
Like, yeah, and even just like meditate on the fact that you just this person come in and the fact that I just readily want to consume that something is up. Somehow. So it's just like, as you were saying, like, and the vehicle, the trip, the bus, I think about just like the journey that desire is. And as you were saying, the vehicle that desire is, and I feel like desire is a vehicle to love, and love is a vehicle to desire in a sense. Because,
a journey.
Yeah.
A journey home.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because it's just like you are using this tool, whether it be love or desire. I think they both can be tools. But love being a tool can actually carry you, or and desire can be a destination actually, but like it can actually open a road or a route to you experiencing desire in many different shapes and forms, and not seeing it as just one thing.
So exploration.
Yeah.
And also I feel like desires are, I think you said it one time, desires are projections that are manifested in the waking world to show us who we are, to show us what we need to tweak and what we need to work on in order for us to come to a sense of what we truly desire. Like, and I feel like when you don't do that, I don't feel like you ever truly know what you desire. Like, you'll just be falling short to these outward desires. And I also feel like desires are not external, but the internal.
Mm-hmm. Internal, like in external manifestation of it, internalized perception of self. So I adding to what KJ had said, like, I feel like you are what you attract what you are. And then that really is just like, whoa, if I'm attracting you and you are messing up my life, no.
They're messing up your life.
You are the messed up life. I shouldn't say that. You started it. Yeah, it's just like you are what you attract, and you won't be attracted to something that you don't connect with, or you aren't. And that's just true. You are not better than anybody else.
Mirrors.
I'm not better than you, honestly.
Yeah.
So just like thinking about that and love, just that love being a vehicle to desire. Like if you truly love something, love yourself, you will actually work to like not represent, but to give or to express in a way that you want to be expressed to, and you'll actually manifest what you want to attract, what you want in your life, rather than, okay, this is who I am and I'm gonna be this way all the time. You're gonna actually attract, this is who you are and this is what you're gonna be all the time, and it's gonna be a cycle of just mess, I guess.
And also, desire and fantasy. Desire and lust.
Actually, we were talking about this, and it was just like we were saying that desire should be explored through experience, and shouldn't be expectations fantasized.
Mm-hmm.
And that's just like, whoa.
Expectations undermine exploration. That's the first thing for like me to say.
There's like a whole limit, like expectations, like it literally does not make anything better. Expectations.
And let's stop saying that I desire you. Let's be real for ourselves and let's say I lust you. Okay.
Yeah, I lust you.
I don't desire you. I just lust you. I lust what you can give. I lust what you make me
think,
feel.
And what I expect you to give.
Mm-hmm.
Friend. But you know, it's interesting though, because I instantly think of lust as craving. And then craving, I mean, I'm sure you guys are ready to eat the food right now, I hope so. But yes.
Well, there's beverages.
Oh, beverages, yeah. But yeah, lust as a craving, and then just how impulsive lust is.
Mm-hmm.
And then with that comes an arousal that you are basically taught to, so that response is a taught response, a learned response. So that lust, that craving, and that impulse, you feel like you have to get it because you want it, not because you desire it, or because it's desirable. And then that, man, I think that's pointing back at me, because I've actually been in that space where, okay, I think this is what I desire. And then recently I've been afraid to use the word desire, because it's just like, well, probably this is not exactly what desire means. Maybe that same lust and that craving, and then we think we actually want something, but we just long for this quality in someone rather than
for it.
Yeah. there, I'm yearning rather than having a desire for it or thinking that we really need this and our life is what we need.
Mm-hmm. And
go ahead.
And desire is not just associated with sex. And I feel like that is what this hypersexualized society likes to projectilize. It's not. Say if you desire some chips. It could be just as simple as that. I desire some chips.
And the chips taste good.
Yeah.
I'm not going to obsess
over
the chips.
It fulfills me.
I'm not obsessing over the chips.
Vegan food. Mm-hmm. I desire vegan food. I want vegan food. Mm-hmm. I yearn for vegan food. And this edifies my soul.
Yes. It's what it does for you rather than the thing. Because the material or the physical addition of the thing is just like not as important as what's doing for you, what it brings to you, what it allows you to think or mm-hmm. feel about yourself or others. And like kind of like moving scales from your eyes.
Yeah.
And it's just like really beautiful.
Yeah, and that comes back to the introspection.
Mm-hmm.
You have to ask your desire. Is this an outward desire or is this an inward desire? And if it's an outward desire, you have to ask yourself, okay, this is outward. So what am I getting from this? Is this helping to grow me?
Mm-hmm.
Or is this helping to just add to my pile of baggage that I already have? You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like just asking desire, like what are you? Like, what are you?
And like baggage that you never really sign up to carry. Like the same bag. Could you carry this bag to school. They voluntarily carry, they know what's in the bag. They know how heavy it is, and that's their bag.
Do you even know what's in the bag?
You must know, you know, you carry the bag. Or I must know what's in the bag. But yeah, it's just like, if you are if you're taking on more baggage, then are you equipped to carry those baggages?
Mm-hmm.
Those bags? Bag lady, you don't break your... Okay.
Sound like that full phone that you ain't even thoroughly wearing. Yeah, so I guess it just comes back to Lois and just like decolonizing
mm-hmm.
or dismantling the way that we see desire
mm-hmm.
or the way that we see
what is desirable.
Yeah,
and what we believe is desirable, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And I think I'd like to share something though about hypersexualization, and I have hypersexualization gives light to a mainstream perception of what desire is.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it being linked to sexual fantasy and the longing to fulfill that fantasy, I feel like it kind of excuses expectation, it excuses fantasizing and excuses loss, and it makes it normalized. Like it's normalized. I feel like loss is normalized. I feel like that mainstream perception of desire is normalized and is seen as facts. And people use the word desire, us included, interchangeably with attraction or love or even lust. So I desire you. No, I'm lusting after you. I'm actually wanting to just have sex with you and taste you and read. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, this hypersexualization is on parts that really come from the root of everything, like even church, like how hypersexualization is seen. Hypersexualization manifests in a way where it's presented as something to be avoided. Something to some sin, basically. Like sex is sin.
Mm.
And then sex is sin. And wanting sex is sin. And feeling aroused is sin, and until you're married.
Feeling human is sin.
Feeling human is sin. How
decolonization.
Yeah, and the other part of the spectrum where everything is about sex. Everything. And it's just like, okay.
That might be the case. It might be.
But it's not desire. We don't think it's desire. it should be just classed as lust.
Mm-hmm.
Because the action, the things attached to that doesn't encompass desire. And desire is, I think desire is tender. And
it's vulnerable.
It's vulnerable.
It's open.
As it's just like, whoa.
It's trusting.
Yeah.
It's evolution.
Yeah, it's a little, it's home.
Sometimes.
But yeah.
Yeah. I think desire is home in its fullness, mm-hmm. to be honest. I feel like everything that you explore through self is home.
Mm-hmm.
To be honest.
Because you're existing in this space.
Because even lust, like if you're being honest with yourself and you're saying, okay, today I'm lusting after this person. And
when
you are making that core
mm-hmm.
with yourself,
mm-hmm.
that is love. Because you're being honest with yourself. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm. I know what I'm saying.
Just being like straight up, like OG type shit, like shit.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay. So I guess so love basically just holding space for the unpacking of that desire
mm-hmm.
going inward.
Mm-hmm.
And not always seeking the external things of this hypersexualized society. And then in regards to art,
mm-hmm.
I see love languages as a form of art
mm-hmm.
when it comes to desire. To be
yeah,
honest.
So that expression and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
I think about the visual as well. So like the art aspect of desire really speaks to you dissecting what you're attracted to. Rather than, okay, I'm attracted to this, I'm gonna jump on this. And then that literally directs you in a, like puts in a direction for lust, like it is lust, but then that dissecting of that and seeing it as art, seeing it as visual stimulation, and then what a stimulation might be rather than sexual stimulation or a stimulation that will push you to want to pursue the person.
Mm-hmm.
So I just feel like that appeal, that appetite that you're talking about, or even that it's like a type of attraction. And then desire is linked with that type, like you have a type.
Mm-hmm.
Like this is what I desire. And then that comes back to the same expectation.
And projections
mm-hmm.
of the manifestation
mm-hmm.
shit
mm-hmm.
with yourself.
Mm-hmm.
Comes back to that. Mm-hmm. You'll be manifesting it when you know it.
What
is a type?
Yeah, what's a type? You actually just like.
Are you putting a boundary around your love? Around your desire?
Yeah, around your identity. And
around
that
expectation.
Around somebody else's identity.
Around the exploration. So.
Yeah. Around somebody's identity, and like, how are you going to actually typify someone? Like, that's your type because they have everything that you expect is good or fantasize as good.
Mm-hmm.
So it's just like dissecting desire, uprooting what was taught.